Well, welcome everyone to the HealthSpan podcast, where we talk about the science of increasing your health span. So I'm your host, Dr. Robert Todd Hurst. I'm a board certified preventive cardiologist and founder of HealthspanMD, a medical practice that delivers healthcare as it should be, with a comprehensive and connected approach to helping our patients live a long and vital life. So today's topic is a special one, maybe a little bit technical, a little bit more clinical than usual. We are going to talk about lipoprotein little A. And lipoprotein little A may be something that you haven't heard of, but my guess is you will hear about lipoprotein little A in the coming years, because it's becoming more recognized the impact this lipoprotein little A has on our health. So first of all, let's talk about what is lipoprotein little A. So it is just a type of cholesterol. It's a certain protein attached to a cholesterol molecule, and it's been called a lipoprotein little A. So why is this important? Well, lipoprotein little A impacts our heart health. It increases the chances of having a heart attack in some studies by up to 300%. It also is a strong risk factor for an increased risk for stroke, for heart failure, for blood clot problems, and also for narrowing of the aortic valve, which is called aortic valve stenosis. So the reason lipoprotein little A is becoming more commonly discussed among doctors and also among patients is because it is the most common genetic cholesterol problem that increases the risk of heart disease. You know, in medicine, we commonly talk about another type of genetic cholesterol problem called familial hypercholesterolemia. That just means a genetic predisposition to having a very high LDL cholesterol. And this is a big clinical problem, but it's uncommon. Only about one in 250 people have a elevated or have familial hypercholesterolemia. But lipoprotein little A, elevated lipoprotein little A is seen in up to 20 to 30% of people. So, you know, the one, it's a really common thing. But number two, we are increasingly knowing what to do with this. We're having tools that we didn't have in the past. And so it's becoming more prominent, but also likely going to be more of an important target for future therapies in helping people lower their risk of heart disease. And, you know, lipoprotein little A among physicians is still a thing that's burgeoning, meaning, you know, people are starting to figure this out. But I know when I give talks to physicians at CME or continuing medical education events where there's, you know, doctors in the audience, when I talk about lipoprotein little A, that's one of the topics I get the most questions on from physicians. So I think physicians have a lot of uncertainty around lipoprotein little A, and patients, of course, have uncertainty around lipoprotein little A. So why are people starting to know more about lipoprotein little A? Well, another reason is that we're testing for it more frequently. More advanced lipid test analysis are including lipoprotein little A. So people are getting that surprise. They get their cholesterol. You know, a standard cholesterol profile doesn't test for lipoprotein little A. These more advanced tests can test for that. And they're finding out, oh my gosh, I have this elevated lipoprotein little A and I don't know what it is and or what does it mean. Another way people are increasingly finding out that they have a elevated lipoprotein little A is genetic testing. So getting, you know, genetic tests like the 23andMe and other forms of genetic testing, people can be identified as having a high likelihood for an elevated lipoprotein little A, and they're trying to figure out what that is. So one, you know, place to start too is, what is the definition of elevated lipoprotein little A? There's still some uncertainty about this. Some different guidelines give different values, but generally a lipoprotein little a that is greater than 50 milligrams per deciliter or 125 nanomolars per liter, that's considered elevated. So it depends on the lab tests, what units that they use. So lipoprotein little a, another important thing to mention about this, if you have lipoprotein little a, is that it is almost all genetic. About 90% of your level of lipoprotein little a is determined by your genes, not by your lifestyle choices. So in general, people can't impact their lipoprotein little a by doing anything lifestyle-wise that would be beneficial. However, as we'll talk about, there is an important opportunity to lower your risk. So maybe not make the lab tests look better, but certainly to lower your risk. So, you know, lipoprotein little a in the HealthspanMD practice, we look at this as four principles for addressing an elevated lipoprotein little a. And before I start, I should say that none of what I'm talking about is meant to be medical advice. This isn't a doctor-patient relationship. These are things to talk with your doctor about to determine what would be the best treatment for elevated lipoprotein little a, if that is your, if you've been identified as having that. So principle number one is to optimize heart health. So as we talked about already, having an elevated lipoprotein little a does increase the risk for heart attacks, for strokes, for heart failure, for blood clot problems, for aortic stenosis, and to lower the risk, particularly of heart attack and stroke, the goal is to optimize all other factors that we know are important. So, you know, there are over 200 independent risk factors for artery disease or heart attack risk. And all of those can, you know, uniquely interact with your genetics to give you your risk. But there are 10 factors that are most powerful in predicting risk for heart disease, for heart attacks. Interestingly, these same 10 factors are most important in predicting risk for cancer, for dementia, for a stroke, and for just how long you live. In our practice, we call these the health span 10, and they are 10 factors that most powerfully predict risk in somebody who has high risk, including if they have an elevated lipoprotein LA, then optimizing these 10 factors is where we start. So the first four of these are outcome goals. These are the ones that we want to get right, and that is to have normal blood pressure, normal blood sugar levels, healthy cholesterol levels, and then a healthy body weight or body composition. And then the other six are the tools we use to move those four outcome goals. So that is nutrition, physical activity, sleep, stress, avoiding toxins, and then staying connected socially, connected to your purpose. When we optimize those 10 things, that's the people that get the most benefit. In some studies, people that do the best at those 10 factors have over 90% less heart disease, about 50% less stroke risk, about 50% less heart cancer risk, and about 40% less dementia, and add 12 to 14 years of life. So optimizing the health span 10, that's principle number one in approaching somebody who has an elevated lipoprotein little a. Principle number two is aggressive lowering of the LDL levels, or more specifically the apoprotein B levels. But in general, most people get their LDL levels. It's kind of a surrogate for ApoB levels. But for people that are at the highest risk, that's one thing that we know can mitigate that risk, is to get that LDL into optimal ranges. Most doctors feel like this is at least less than 70 milligrams per deciliter, even more aggressive for people at highest risk may be indicated. So that's where you would talk to your physician about what would be an optimal LDL or ApoB level to get to the lowest risk of future heart disease without causing you any adverse effects. Principle number three is lower lipoprotein little A levels. And the reason that we don't start that as principle number one is because we don't have currently great ways or easy ways to lower lipoprotein little A levels. Niacin is a vitamin that has been shown to impact cholesterol. It lowers LDL, it raises HDL, lowers triglycerides, and it also can lower lipoprotein little A levels. Although in my experience, when I used to use this in my practice, when that was kind of the way that we were doing things, I found it to be quite variable. Sometimes it worked, sometimes it didn't. Niacin, the prescription form is Niaspan, tends to have a lot of adverse effects, particularly flushing for people that for some it's intolerable. But the main reason we don't use niacin or Niaspan particularly much anymore is because we've had large outcome trials that showed no clinical benefit. So it looks like niacin, Niaspan makes the labs look better, but doesn't change outcome, doesn't change the risk of heart attacks and strokes. And in one study, there was even a slight increase in bleeding in the brain, which was a secondary outcome, certainly not cause and effect, but at least enough of a risk to say, if there's not much benefit here or no benefit here, why would we accept any risk? Now we have some new therapies that do work that are available right now. One is a procedure. It's called LDL apheresis. This is a procedure. It's basically like dialysis for your cholesterol. People at really high risk, really high cholesterol, can come in every 2 to 4 weeks and they're hooked up to a machine. Their blood is filtered. It takes a couple of hours and they get their cholesterol cleaned out of the bloodstream, the cholesterol lowered dramatically. This is infrequent. There's not many places that do this. It's not many people that need to do this, but it can be life-saving for some people that have really high risk and really high cholesterol. Tends to be also really expensive, but can lower LPL, lipoprotein little A levels by up to 70%. And this data, it's being done in Europe more than it is in the United States, or at least the research studies have been done more commonly in Europe. And there's some evidence that lowering lipoprotein little A levels by LDL apheresis improves outcomes. And this is a really important point, and one that we still don't know is, for sure, does lowering lipoprotein little A actually change outcomes, change heart attack risk, change stroke, heart failure, aortic stenosis risk? That's to be determined. We it makes sense that it would be beneficial, but we don't know that for sure yet. And that's important to keep in mind as we're exploring these new therapies for lowering lipoprotein little A. Another thing that makes us timely to talk about lipoprotein little A is just in the last several months, there has been a report in the New England Journal of Medicine, the most prestigious medical journal in the world, of a new medication, not available, not FDA approved yet, but a new medication. It's called a small interfering RNA medication that lowers lipoprotein little A levels by over 95%. So this is an exciting development. It's still early in this process, but something on the horizon. And that would be, a medication that if it passes through the FDA approval, it meets safety criteria and is tested, that might be our first find, where we find out, does lowering lipoprotein little A change outcomes for people? And as we talked about in the beginning, up to 20 to 30% of people have elevated lipoprotein little A levels. So this could be an important medication for our battle to decrease heart attacks, to lower heart disease from being the number one cause of death and disability, and bring it down to being the preventable disease that we know it can be and should be. And then the last principle I want to talk about is the idea of lipoprotein little A increasing the risk of blood clot problems. So lipoprotein little A has some similarities to another factor called plasminogen that is involved in the clotting cascade. And so it's been talked about for years that maybe people with elevated lipoprotein little A should take aspirin to lower their risk of forming blood clots. Well, there's been no evidence that that was of benefit. And in my practice, I did not make that recommendation. And there still isn't definitive evidence about this, but there was a recent study that showed that in people who have a genetic testing that shows that they would have a lipoprotein little A, so important to note, this research study did not assess if they had elevated lipoprotein little A, just looked at whether they had the genetics for elevated lipoprotein little A. Those people that took aspirin did better than those people who did not. This is preliminary. This does not mean that everybody with elevated lipoprotein little A should take aspirin, because aspirin does have adverse effects, as bleeding risk. We generally don't use aspirin in primary prevention, meaning somebody who's not had a heart attack or stroke, not had a stent or a bypass surgery, because the risks of bleeding are about the same or maybe even a little higher than the benefits of lowering the risk of heart attacks. But in people with elevated lipoprotein little A, it's worth that discussion with the physician. And I think that decision has to be made with your physician. What is your bleeding risk? What is the heart disease risk? Would taking an aspirin make sense? That's something else that should be discussed between you and your physician. So that's lipoprotein little A. Our practice, HealthspanMD, specializes in that comprehensive connected approach to get people that have higher risk for heart disease, for higher risk for cancer, higher risk for stroke, that have evidence of metabolic disease, blood pressure, cholesterol, prediabetes, give them the connected comprehensive care that we know is effective in lowering the risk for these diseases so they can live a long and vital life. So if you have an elevated lipoprotein little A, you'd like to learn more about our practice, we'd love for you to schedule an appointment. Just go to healthspanmd.com and submit a request for an appointment. We'd love to see you. Okay, so thank you all for joining us today. It's been a pleasure to be here. We look forward to seeing you back in the new year to continue to talk about the topics important, the science in increasing your health span. Have a great day, everybody. Thank you so much.
This information is for educational purposes only and is not medical advice. Don't make any decisions about your medical treatment without first talking to your doctor. Thanks for watching, and if you want to learn more about living a long, healthy life you love, click the link below to learn more about how we help people increase their health span. And if you like this video, hit the like button below, share it with your friends, and be sure to hit the bell and subscribe.